Tony, I want to start with you and your reaction when you read what the president wrote this morning about LaVar Ball. What is it about LaVar Ball that bothers the president so much? Is it what he said or, as some are alleging, how he looks?
Both. So, first of all, his father is a tall black man, and I think Trump is half awed and half frightened by black people. And his only way of dealing with them is to attack them. And on the other hand, I think he has a zero tolerance for any criticism of any kind. That's why he goes after anybody who says virtually anything about him that's negative.
See, awed and afraid of black people. That's a big statement right there, based on what?
Well, I mean, I watched him. I mean, he was awed, unequivocally awed, during the many times I saw him with, you know, members of the team that he owned in the USFL, and when he sponsored fights, prize fights. I think he had this kind of ambivalent relationship where he wished he could have been an athlete like they were, and on the other hand, if he felt fear, he always felt aggression. And aggression was, and a need to put them down.
You know, Michael, you see him in these battles. Will he ever stop fighting? Once he picks an enemy, and we've talked about how he does a certain kind of enemy shopping, will he ever let up?
Well, he does shop for enemies. I think what Tony said was correct, that there are these dual motivations on his part. On the one hand, it is racial. On the other hand, he's very thin-skinned. But I think that we have to notice who he responds to, and he will go after someone who he can frame perfectly, often for his base. So in this case, this is yet another member of the black community, also someone connected to the world of sports. He initiated a lot of the furor over the Pledge of Allegiance, the Star Spangled Banner protests because it was black athletes. I didn't see that he ever actually went after any of the white players who knelt in solidarity with their black teammates. So there is this desire, I think, to find the right person to go after who fits a certain template. He doesn't go after little guys who happen to be white. I've noticed that. He kind of leaves those folks alone. And if he can pick out a target who is different from him and whom his base may also resent, that's the person he'll go after.
During the campaign, I mean, he went after Jeb Bush plenty. I mean, you know, it was low-energy Jeb, and, you know, Rand Paul, he said, was funny-looking. There was lying Ted Cruz, and then, of course,
these were people he was running against for president.
Okay, but it was in a setting where he talked about them, and they weren't African-American, so that was, you know, a bit of another thing. I want to ask about the Trump brand, if I can, because we learned tonight that the Trump organization is severing ties, or being severed, with the Trump Soho, a hotel downtown, ostensibly because the deal's not going the way they want it to right now. And it just does beg the question, do you think that the Trump brand has suffered? Does this show that the brand as a business has suffered during the presidency?
Well, I mean, I think there's no question that it's suffered and that it's been split down the middle, just as America has. And those who support Trump would continue to, you know, be inclined to go to his hotels and use his golf courses, and the rest of the country is very disinclined to do that. You know, what I'm actually really struck by about Trump is how aggressively he's moved toward kind of an authoritarian perspective. I the biggest fear I have is not whether he tweets about people, but it's about whether he moves in the direction of a dictator. You know, I have a dance teacher named Dimitri who is Russian, and he's my touchstone. And he refers to Trump as a kind of a poor man's Putin. And Trump, I think, models himself after Putin. And the problem is that we don't have anybody to model ourselves after in this country right now. You need people to idealize. You need role models. And you watch what's happening, I think, especially to the male psyche right now in the absence of anything to that you can idealize. And it's troubled and scary and frightening.
Tony Schwartz, Michael D'Antoni. Let me just say happy Thanksgiving, completely in a vacuum of anything else going on around us. Thank you, gentlemen, for being with us. I appreciate it.
Thanks, John.